kedves vendégeink, akkor most a panelbeszélgetés következik. Kérem, hogy Attila foglaljon helyet. Feri. And now we are turning to English.
Yes. I ask how rules are that we are an academic community, so we don't want to be very formal. So a few comments and questions from Attila and maybe myself, and then we would open the floor and first would give back the words to you. So Attila, book.
Much has been said about the concept of Central Europe so far, but relatively little about the subtitle of the book. So that why is the future of Central Europe to be decided in Central Europe? When
the future of Europe.
So this could be interpreted in two ways. One possible way of interpretation is that this is the most advanced part of Europe, so this would set an example. This is not the interpretation that they give, but this is the trouble spot of Europe. Unfortunately, due to historical reason, it is this part of Europe that is encountering the major threats that Europe has to face. And one proposal, one suggestion of the book is if there is a V4 plus 2 cooperation, the plus 2 meaning Austria and Slovenia, this might give an opportunity to set an example how cooperation could be more important than conflict, and this way trying to set an example for the whole process of European integration. This is, I put it on the table whether I properly understood your interpretation. But I should, because this is meant to be a discussion, I thought of asking a few questions and controversial issues. The first is, at various points in the book, you refer to the survival of communist structures. Is it really the case? Is the problem that communist structures survived, or the problem is that the new structures do not work? So I think this is a different approach. The second question, in a very conscious way, I am trying to be provocative. Is a cooperation based on values that are difficult to clarify, as you point out several times in the book, is it really better than a pragmatic, praxis-oriented, down-to-earth type of cooperation? This is my second question. The third is that I think the book is teaching us a lesson, because you are talking a lot about the possibilities of Austria and the responsibility of Austria in this case. So to what extent you think that Austria might be the guiding force in this Central Europe being made, where the future of Europe is decided or not. The next provocative question is, what is the right answer to radical Islam? Because you devote, if you compare this book to other books about the region, you devote more space to religious problems than other books in the field. And of course, an obvious issue is, what is the right answer to radical Islam? And you have two possible answers. One is secularization, or the strengthening of other religions, that is, giving more and more support to Christian churches. This is, I think, it's a very, very difficult it's very difficult to answer this question. Last, because I think we have to limit ourselves, is I should like to comment on your remarks concerning the responsibility of historians, being a historian. So, and I think, in a most humble and modest way, that I think more has been done than what you are referring to. Because, for example, you are referring to the lack of multilateral cooperations among historians. Now, here, in front of a public, I should like to call attention to an international European organization, the European Network of Remembrance and Solidarity, with its headquarters, with its headquarters in Warsaw, which is based on a German-Polish cooperation, but Hungary, Slovakia, and in indirect way Austria and the Czech Republic also participate in that. I think relatively much has been done along the way that you suggest. For example, most recently, an exhibition was set up about the aftermath of the First World War from 1918 or 1923, an exhibition that was the result of a cooperation among Hungarian, Polish, Czech, Slovak, Austrian, Romanian historians. You can imagine how difficult it might be to work out a common platform. And now this exhibition is traveling all around Europe. So I think this is a minor step, but an important one. So thank you very much for the book. I can also only conclude by saying that I can really, at this point, hardly imagine any other book that would take us exactly to the center of the problems of European integration, because in fact, this is addressing not so much Central Europe, but the key issues of the present uncertain times in the history of European integration.
Thank you, Attila. I try to be short because I'm more interested in your questions and the answers from Emil and Erhard. But I think we should tell you how the idea was born to publish this book. We were in on a holiday, I think, in Austria, when I just accidentally saw this book in a shop window of a bookstore, maybe in Wiener Neustadt. And I bought it, it was last year, and I read it immediately. And I was incredibly relieved, and I would say enthusiastic and happy. The reason is that this Central European discourse used to be restricted to our small circles here in Hungary, maybe in other countries. It didn't get any echo in the last, I would say, 30 years. The situation was different in the 80s, when, as mentioned in the book, and maybe already mentioned by Ivan, we used to have a Central European debate. In Hungary, several people, like Miklós Mészöly, and a lot of people in the opposition, some historians, picking up the idea of Kundera, György Konrád, and in other countries, Václav Havel and people in Chapter 77, were discussing Central Europe as a system transcending concept. It helped East and Central European opposition, so-called democratic opposition, people in Solidarność and Chapter 77, and people in Romania and former Yugoslavia, to find a common denominator. We did not know, how could we know that the Iron Curtain is going to to be broken down, that there will be a political change and upheaval, and that revolutions are coming. There was a hope about it, and for ourselves, it was more than a cultural concept. It was the platform of networking and the platform of solidarity. And it was very, very, very important and helpful psychologically as well as politically. I don't want to be long about this. There were movements, grassroots movements, more or less everyone knows about it, although from the mainstream political science and social sciences, it's almost completely missing. Neither the political class, the political parties, nor social scientists pay attention that there was a strong civil society cooperation, first of all, within the region. We were able to learn from each other's experience and, if you want, mistakes. For example, the revolution of 56 had certain conclusions. The Polish Solidarność leaders understood that they should avoid with any means violence, so not to provoke the Communist Party or the Soviet Union up to the degree when violence will be introduced. And I could go on and on. So non-violence, cooperation, networking, solidarity, a lot of elements of a new discourse, and I would say a paradigm. We just, together in a conference with Attila and Jody in Moscow, when this issue was raised, how prominent West European thinkers like Jürgen Habermas and many others believed that in 89, in the 89 revolutions, there was nothing original and nothing new. And here is the core of the problem. Where we, a small group of intellectuals, students, and artists, cooperating and networking and thinking together about the future of Europe and using Central Europe as a system transcending concept, we believe that this is going to continue after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the Iron Curtain. And that was a very misleading position. The other side of the problem is very well described in the book, that 89, 91, the collapse of the Soviet Union, was a big surprise for our West European friends and colleagues. And these two parts of Europe, although we were formally pursuing the same purpose, to create a cooperating larger continent, we simply did not understand each other. So my humble proposition, what I'm thinking about the last 30 years, is that maybe we have here friends from natural sciences, physicists, etc., and talking a lot about a new conceptualization of social sciences. Maybe it's a misperception to think that we have a linear time sequence. It was, in my understanding, probably not 30 years, which certainly passed. It is one moment which actually evolved and erupted in a certain way, and it's a self-actualization of the potential of 89. And the result of it is fragmentation instead of integration, and the knowledge, what I think we share, most of us, that we understand that we do not understand each other. That we are different in our perceptions, in our efforts, many, even if we share the same Christian values, whatever you call the European values. So here is my question to you. If you agree that there is a time, a new moment, a momentum, if you want, to start the missing dialogue and to cure this basic problem of mutual non-understanding each other, the lack of understanding of each other. The book, in many ways, is very, very optimistic, because the author suggests that there will be a successful European integration with the help of Central Europe. And sometimes, from a Central European perspective, we don't see this possibility, honestly, in our everyday praxis. I personally am an optimistic person, and I think that we should work on it, but for that we need mutual efforts. And my second question is, where do you see, not the seeds, because let's say this Austro-Hungarian academic cooperation might be, I'm ironically saying it, the beginning of a new discourse, but in a larger way, in other countries, in Poland or in what we call the Western Balkans. I very much agree about the larger conception of Central Europe, that the Balkans countries belong to Central Europe, I think. But do you see the real efforts, the real possibilities? And if yes, in what? And my third comment is that I'm very glad to read in the book at the end concrete suggestions about cooperation, concrete cooperation between cities, universities, municipalities, and so on and so forth. And we are very much here in this institute, very much in this line. And here, I can just say that we would like to host a series of discussions to find out what we do have in common, because the mainstream politics and the mainstream social sciences is not taking these issues seriously, I think. So we need to change. We need to change the discourse. So this is what I wanted to say, and I would like to maybe give you the word, Emil and Erhard.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here, and let me, in the name of both of us, thank you for this perfect translation and for inviting us. So many questions. I'm not sure whether we can answer them all, but it's good that the book looks to, it raises questions. That's a good thing. So let me start by saying it was well understood that the subtitle of the book is much more important than the title. Forget about the title. It's not about definition what Central Europe is, or whether we visited or revisited, or we thought even about calling it Central Europe Reloaded. We decided against it and called it then Revisited, not to be sort of too populistic in the title. But it's about the subtitle. Why? Because it is our proposition that if the integration project in Europe will have a chance, it needs to take in the differences, experiences, and value systems of the Central European region. Why? Because in this region, there you have so many historic examples of how to overcome differences, how to live with ambivalences, what sort of conflicts come out of that. And that is, by example, one of the reasons why a lot of Brussels bureaucrats and politicians think about the experience of the Habsburg monarchy when they talk about how can we reform the European Union. It's not because anyone believes that this was such a beautiful system, but because there is a belief in Brussels that we can learn from the mistakes of this multinational entity. And that's what we try to say. We are going into a time where the differences in the European Union will increase. And it is exactly the line here in Central Europe, and the second one probably between North and South, which will be the deciding lines whether this project has a chance. With Brexit, a rich, one of the biggest, third largest economies will leave this European project. Who will be next? The Netherlands? Denmark? I don't know. And what will remain? The poorer Central Europeans and Germany, because Germany feels it has to be European because of its historic time. So we can rely on this. But what sort of Europe is this then, actually? So what we need is ideas, and that's why we wrote this book, Ideas Coming from This Central European Background on How a Reform of the European Union Can Look Like. And it was all mentioned, we are talking about centers and peripheries, that creativity very often come from peripheries because the challenges are much bigger there and because the ambivalences are much bigger there. So one of you asked the questions, why should the periphery be interesting for the future of Europe? Because innovation very often comes from this challenge of the periphery and of changing borders, changing languages, changing traditions. So that's something that we can bring, we Central Europeans can bring into the European dialogue. And then you asked about the Homo Sovieticus. And that's where I think this book is asking for a revolution. It's asking for a revolution in the mind of people, and this concerns my country, because Austria has had to learn, for good reasons, that we are Western. And Erhard Busek knows more than I, when we talked also to politicians in Austria, even from our own party, most of them felt the Atlantic is much closer to us than Bratislava. This was very obvious. So it took a long time to change the mind of the Austrians. Now, I think even the last figures that I saw, when the Austrians were asked who is our most popular neighbor, is Hungary, which was never the case before 1989. So it was always Germany. Luckily, it is no longer Germany, by the way. So these sort of basic changes have also to happen on this other side of this Iron Curtain at that time. And there, the remnants of Homo Sovieticus are still, one can see them. And they would even go as far when you look into originally radical liberal politicians in Central Europe, who are now speaking about the strong state, the order system which has to be taken, the strong role also of one idea, be they Christian or religious, or be they socialist like in China, is a good thing. And it's also good that because you can make economic progress without political freedom. So I think this idea that you can have political success and keep your country together without political freedom is something which is from the Homo Sovieticus time and which is still in Hungary and Poland, but also in the Czech Republic and Slovakia. It's quite around. So I would say
there is a lot of work to do, and there we ask for a second revolution on our side and on this side. And the third point, and it's, I already tried to answer that, you asked about the role of Austria. In the history, Austria mostly played not a very modest role. So I think we have learned our lesson that we should play a modest role. But we were on the lucky side after the Second World War. So we have some sort of responsibility to try to work on this difficult world of Central Europe and to make something out of that. And I'm here, I have to say, I'm also feeling a little bit responsible because it is such a poetic quality that is in this notion of Central Europe and the Danube area in the region. I always appreciate when we have structures in the European Union, how we can better use the Danube area, how we can navigate the Danube. But behind that, there is an idea. There's an idea which crosses ethnic borders, which crosses religious borders, and still finds something in common. And that is something in times that we have now, where the nation state has come back so strongly in Europe, is something we should not lose. This is calling for the revolution in the sense that there must be an alternative to the pure dominance of the nation state, because with the pure dominance of the nation state, we will have no more WTO, we will have no more European integration, I'm sure we will have NATO, but that's not enough. So that's why we ask for this. About religion, I will ask Erhard to say more, only about historians and history. Yes, there have been many attempts, but when I look into the attempts, most of them actually showed the problem more than gave a solution. There was, for instance, a big project of a common history book of Poland and Russia, run by the former Polish foreign minister and by a leading intellectual president of MGIMO, the main international school in Moscow. They did not achieve a common history book of Poland and Russia. What they achieved was only that there is one part which shows the narrative of Poland and the other Russian side. So that is not acceptable for us Central Europeans. That's dangerous, actually. Because it will deepen even the national narratives in that. So that's why I'm afraid that historians sometimes still play the role of the 19th century nationalist movements. I'm sure the individual historians see it differently, but the main thrust is that we are living in a time, also in Central Europe, where we have to make sure that our experience of power sharing, of crossing borders, of loving this ambivalence, of translating books and ideas is most important. My last sentence is about the new Commissioner for Foreign Affairs, Mr. Borrell. He started with a letter asking his colleagues, all foreign ministers, that Europe must have the language of power. I like the idea that he's asked for the language of power. But what does he mean? Is it only the language of power? Whose power is it? Is it then the power of the big members again? Is he asking for the French and the Germans to take over? I'm afraid so. I absolutely agree that in the new geopolitical arena, Europe should have a voice which is as much in common as possible, but which is a voice which takes in not only the loudest and those who cry the most. So there is a chance. That's why also we wrote this book. We believe that because in Central Europe you are crossing borders which normally politicians and bureaucrats in European unions are not crossing. For instance, the border between the netto paying country and the netto receiving country. The country where migration is seen as something positive and something where it's seen more critical. The country where workers are sent to other parts of the European Union and countries where workers are received, like Romania and Austria. This is very difficult, but if we don't achieve that we are crossing these borders in a political discourse and also in an intellectual discourse, then there is no future for the European Union. I believe optimistically that it's possible to do this, and somehow my historic experience was in 1900, Budapest 1900, Vienna 1900, which could be, I use the ugly word, could be cosmopolitan in a Central European context. And I think that's why you were absolutely right when you said progress sometimes is a very strange concept. It may come and go, and maybe rather look at what's going on, what are our chances to do a revolution today and not ask for the progress as we do in business cycles. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I want to say many thanks. You would say that's natural. A speaker has to be polite, especially if we are presented in such a way. No, I think it's showing in another direction. I was remembering by the introductory remarks that Hungarian activity on Közép-Európa in a written and printed way, I met some months after the downfall of the Iron Curtain and the change of the political system here in Hungary. It was a group of youngsters being engaged in cultural question, and they brought out a journal, a magazine, under the title Közép-Európa. That impressed me very much because I think we had before the easier possibilities to give out something what is named Central Europe. We didn't do it. I think it was done here in Hungary, and I have respect for this group, which did it. It survived, I think, 2.5 years. Obviously, I think it was not possible to raise enough money for Közép-Európa in this time, but it was done. And this I will always keep in my memory, saying also many thanks, naturally, that we are now sitting here and speaking about. On what want I to focus by listening to the different comments here? First of all, I think we are always in a time where we're criticizing that not enough is achieved and what problems are existing and so on and so on. Here I may say, by these 33 years since the time we edited our first book, I think a lot of things have moved. If you read this book, I'm not asking you to do this, I think here we are writing about the dividing line of the Iron Curtain and had some thoughts, and it might happen that in the future these dividing lines may fall down and we are coming in together. It was only a kind of hope, of a perspective. And then we did a lot of arguments why it would be very good and what is really basic and what is in common, but in reality there was nothing. And I think it has, especially on such a day, mentioned 3 years later, it has happened. We have to criticize we are happy that it has happened, but we have also to be critical, we have not been prepared. That has to be said also quite straight, and that's one of the problems. It is a question, can you be prepared concerning changes which are happening? I have the feeling that I'm defending a little bit our unpreparedness, that I think to a lot of events which happened in history with consequences, we are not showing preparedness. I think the most nicest remark did the last Prime Minister of GDR, of DDR, with the name Mézier. Pretty well known name in German politics also nowadays. I think I was joining him in a discussion about unification. And he said, I have to say straight to my Western German friends, they had a ministry for reunification, but they did not know how to do it. And I think that's one of the problems we have. I think we still are not really aware how to do the things more coming together. We learned a lot, that's a positive side, but I think we have to move forward quite straight in this direction, and maybe what we are discussing here is of great importance. The role of Austria, it was mentioned in one of the comments, what did the Austrians do? What is the responsibility of the Austrians? We had a foreign minister, a very nice lady, I appreciate her very much, but she was proposing strategic cooperation. And that was totally refused by the other, by misunderstanding, because the understanding of strategic was it is a military cooperation. I think if you know this lady, it was never time military, really. I think it was friendly meant, but obviously misunderstood. And I think out of this story we can learn it's not a question of getting a leading role in the process. I think what we have to learn really, and it might be that the size of the states in Central Europe are a precondition for better. There is no strategic importance of the one against the other and so on and so on. I think it can be done only by a real partnership, which is not only to mention, but it should be really done in a down-to-earth cooperation, I think, which is here quite necessary. So far to this strategy. But I think to go further on, what is the reason also for this book? I think we had a better time after the downfall of the Iron Curtain of closer cooperation. It concerns me very much. I think for the main part of my political life, I was fighting for a better understanding of our neighbors. Because neighborhood is very much based that we are able to understand the neighbor. You have to know who is your neighbor, how is your neighbor, and so on, which we are not enough doing, even after 30 years. I think in the beginning it's quite understandable. I think discussing it through half Europe, I had always a problem that Slovenia and Slovakia was mixed up, and I was very happy that we had no Slavonia, because otherwise I think it would be even more difficult, and so on. I think even my impression is that in the last years we didn't come closer together. I think we were getting more distance. Distance, not because we are against them or that there are some hostilities existing. I think it's a lack of interest. It's a lack of interest that we are not really looking what are the problems of our neighbor, because we are very much interested that the neighbors are knowing our problems. I think it is one of the traditional Austrian behaviors. I think if we are misunderstood by neighbors, then they are saying it's typical for them. They have never understood that. That we also never have understood the others is, I think, the right answer, which we have to do for sure. I think it is a learning process. So far, I'm always sure that the question of education and information plays a very important role. We have a time where we have the availability of information, I think, in a large way. But are we really using it in the right way? This question has for sure been raised. The interesting situation is tourism is growing. I think it is substantial to travel to the neighbors and so on and so on. But I'm always raising the question, is there a real understanding created by this? Or even our prejudges getting more foundation, because if we are traveling to our neighbors and say, so they are, that's quite primitive. Why? That makes for sure no sense. I think it is a real contrast program. Officially, we are always speaking about human rights, humanities, and so on. But the realization in basics, I think, is sometimes really missing. And so far, I think in this direction has to be done more. Why? And this I have to add. It is not only the relations of neighbors here in Central Europe. I think we are getting an input from different sides by migration. And here, out of this migration case, a lot of difficulties and misunderstandings are also for sure coming. I think I'm not happy about the message which was always given in Austria, we closed the borders on the Balkans. I think it's not true, because by immigration, we Austrians are very much depending on the immigration of the Balkans. We are solving our problems in labor force, we are solving our problems in social affairs, we are solving our problems under the health professions, and so on. I think that's not said quite clearly. We are depending on each other, and that has to be more elaborated for sure as it is done until now, including the situations that we are getting newer situation. I started my political life being sometimes involved in questions with religion. I think it was not so difficult. We had to do more to understand Protestant neighbors because we have a Protestant minority, but it is really shrinking. As I grew up, 8% of the Austrians were Protestants. Now it's between 2 and 3%. But others are coming up for sure. That's a problem with Islam and existing. We have also a problem, I think, to understand each other, and it is a common problem here for the region. There are a lot of possibilities. I think it is a shock for the Austrian Information Society that we have now a research done that even the Afghans have an understanding for democracy. I think the reaction in the newspapers is, why do they have an understanding for democracy? Because this is not the image of the Afghans which is here existing. No? So far, immediately it is said by some commentators that cannot be true. Which is also a very interesting reaction, because if something is not following our prejudices, then it is not true. I think we have to ask what shall be really true, our prejudices or the right judgment on the question, but that's for sure another question. And I think it was also mentioned here by the introductions, what is the momentum of this being together here in Central Europe. I think the momentum should be, and I touched it a little bit with my last remark here, I think to solve problems together, to have the capacity to solve the problems together. Danube was mentioned, and in presence of an ambassador to the Danube Commission, I may say, the Danube is in Austria not a real problem. It is a mythology. We are looking at the mythology. Our contribution to solve the problems of the River Danube in general is not too much, I have to confess it. It is a mythology because now the famous concert of the Philharmonics is coming again, Sylvester and New Year's concert. I think the Danube waltz of Johann Strauss at the port, and everybody is applauding, and we are happy. We have the real feeling of the Danube and so on, being together. That's it. It's a celebration for 2 hours, and then it's done. I think involvement in the Danube is really, I have to confess it to you, in limits. And it is not a real discussion. Because the real interesting phase of the Danube is that 14 different states are in this Danube region. And I think the mixture of languages, of culture, and so on, is really big and is very impressive. I'm always mentioning the longest river in Europe is the Volga. I think the Volga has one problem, but also one advantage. Only Russians are living there. I think the river Danube, Tatars aside, sometimes changed by Stalin, putting off, putting on, and so on. And I think this we have to consider. It is a learning phase. I think the book has also the intention concerning the importance for the future of Europe, that it is a learning procedure which we have to do. And then I have to underline this subtitle. Partly it was already mentioned. I think Central Europe is close to the areas where Europe might have problems in the future. I think going to the south, to the East Mediterranean area, this is a volatile region here, having a huge impact on the European situation. I think if the things are not really going quite well by the enlargement, will we have an enlargement? The question which we have to raise. It's not looking like, for my feeling, what is happening here at the Bosporus, what is happening here in Syria, and so on. It has a deep impact on our situation, and I think we are not really prepared. I think so we might learn, we have not been prepared that the Iron Curtain will fall down. We are learning on the subject, we are still in the learning process, but we shall look also to the consequences out of it, and they will be quite huge, especially for Central Europe. And here we cannot say the others are the responsible. For Central Europe, Brussels is not responsible. That makes no sense. The United Kingdom, we can forget in the moment because they have the problem, are they a part of Europe, yes or no? So far, it's quite different. So far, they are not even a part of Central Europe, by this understanding. I think here can see where the things are. And so far, I have to say many thanks for the perception of the book. We are really proud. We are already translated in the Ukrainian language, into the Hungarian language, it's quite close. You can consider why it is done in Ukraine and Hungary. I think because some problems are connected with this. We are trying to get an English translation. May I tell you, it's quite more complicated than to get a translation in such languages, which are more a minority or not so much connected. It is a possibility, I think, to create more connections. And that's a sense. Because basics, Kasaparopa, the Danube region, I think a river shall connect and not divide. I may raise the question, is the river connecting or dividing? Is Central Europe connected or are we really divided? I think we have to answer this question.
Ladies and gentlemen, the floor is open. Any questions, any remarks? Marta and Monica.
Thank you, Ivan. So my question is, I totally agreed with you that the nationalist narrative is outdated, of course. It's a 19th century construction and it's not possible to maintain anymore. In this format, in the 19th century, it was born, right? But beyond that, there was a culture identity which was provided for those people who lived in the Austro-Hungarian Empire. We know it from the books of Karl Sorske, Peter Honák, or Moritz Csáky. So through music, literature, architecture, people shared, were able to share that identity, and if they went to anywhere from Lemberg to Vienna, Budapest, etc., etc., they could sit down in the coffee house and, you know, discussing news from all over the monarchy and meet people and be integrated in some ways within a couple of hours. So I think this kind of integration was a given thing for those people. So my question is whether you can see in any ways an alternative to this in a global world when it's difficult to get an English translation for a book about Central Europe, or more difficult than a Ukrainian translation. So can you see any alternative to the 19th century option?
Thank you very much. Excuse me for any further questions. Yes.
Jozef Berács, I can't remember 30 years ago in 1990, there was a conference at the IMC, International Management Center, and there was an invited American top economics professor, Lester Suro, and he raised the question, who owns the 21st century? And he answered immediately that it will be Central Europe. So my question, you know, could be regarding you as well, that even from economics perspective, because at the beginning, the privatization, foreign direct investment, etc., it was a very attractive place to come for the Western, for Central Europe as well. So the momentum, which is in the subtitle of your book as well, is it really coming, or what are those global issues which can give you some kind of positive answer?
No. My name is Ferenc Hörcher. I'm coming from the Institute of Politics of Government at the National University of Public Service in Budapest. And I mention it because there is a connection between this institution and my one, which is by the name of George Schöpflin, an earlier member of the European Parliament from Hungary's side, and now a researcher at my institute, and also one who is connected to this one. And he has got a project entitled The Future of Europe. because, of course, the European agenda is open right now with the new European leadership. Can I have a more provocative question beside thanking for you for your coming and also for the book, which I really liked? Try to be more provocative. Two sides of it. One side is the issue of post-communism. I think it's crucial to understand that there is a you keep returning to the democratic deficit, and I think that's a crucial issue in Europe. But there is a further aspect of deficits in the European balance, and one of that is this historical deficit of post-communism, I guess. We talked about it at lunch with Erhard because we thought that that perhaps there is here a missing link to end up the post-communist era period by a kind of a gesture which is still lacking. I think, at least in the perception of people of Central Europe. And a further aspect which comes to my mind connected to post-communism is the issue of nationalism. When you talk about the 20th century in your book, the opposition that you make is between nationalism and communism as two of the possible dangers. First of all, I think that this is a bit distorting if you don't confront communism with Nazism or National Socialism and not nationalism. So in this respect, I have got a small debate here. And also, I guess that nationalism in the context of those Central European countries which went through the communist experience means something different than in other European countries. We lived through a totalitarian regime which was international, which denied the possibility of identifying with your national roots, and therefore there is a pendulum effect right now on the other way around. So I think that if you try to make sense of nationalism in this part of the world, you have to take into account this international totalitarian past as well. So that's also connected to the post-communism issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you. My name is András Nagy, and thank you for the book, which is really excellent, and thank you for coming here. I just have one question which was very important for me, the role of culture that is playing. So I think this is really kind of integrative force, and you were referring how important the cultural progress, how important the cultural identity for Central and Eastern Europe, and there is no question, no antagonism when we are arriving to culture. And I recall quite well in the late 80s when you were the Minister of Culture, Education, Research, and so on, how Vienna became extremely attractive. You had Klaus Peymann as the director of Burgtheater, you had Claudio Abbado as the director of opera, none of them Austrian, you had Laurent Hedy, the Hungarian art historian, as the director of modern museum, and so on. So that kind of internalization of the that time still closed Austrian borders behind Vienna was extremely attractive and contributed enormously to those people who were living behind the Iron Curtain that had a chance somehow already to go there. How do you see, is there any chance right now to find again that kind of common integrity, that kind of common integrative force that culture could and should play? Are there the institutions? I was also impressed how you are referring to Claudio Magris, Peter Esterházy, Kundera, Konrad, all these wonderful writers, intellectuals. How would you find the today's important opinion-leading personalities in this sense that could help to create a new identity, a very troubled one in the present situation, who could play a role again to find, to redefine Central Europe, the new tragedy that we may approach if we are not careful enough, and how we can handle that? The other thing is that why Central Europe should be decided about the future of Europe, I have my kind of historical background that it was decided once in Sarajevo, second time in Danzig. I wouldn't be unhappy the third time to have somewhere else to be decided.
Thank you very much, Excellencies.
Should we respond? Yeah. Regarding the last question, I am also not happy that this sort of decision should be taken here, but it was not by chance that it was decided where it was decided in the 20th century. The first issue, is there an alternative, and would we like to have an alternative to the national narrative of the 19th century? Yes. actually that is what we are living in at the moment. We are trying to create a narrative which is with shared, we call it shared sovereignty between Europe and the nation state. It's not very successful so far. Every member country has a different idea about this. My esteemed co-author is criticizing me when I think our prime minister, former prime minister, is right, asking for more subsidiarity and less regulation and a bit more nation states and a bit more patriotism in Austria. So every member country has a problem with it, but it is the only model in town at the moment in Europe. And I think it's a good model. And that could be something which is helpful, because we were asked, is there anything on a global scale that we can participate? That might be something that we can contribute. Also helping in national conflicts and ethnic conflicts you have around the globe. And it is also, I think, an alternative to the Chinese or Russian model of, which is not ethnic, but which is built on authoritarian capitalism or something like that. So there is a model. When you ask me, will we be able to really realize it? I like the contention at the moment, which is happening between, for instance, Hungary and France, or I even like the contentious issues between Macedonia, North Macedonia, and France. I think these are moments of debate. And necessary for making decisions. Not that if I would be a North Macedonian, I would feel humiliated, certainly. But looking at it like a bird on the situation in Europe, I think important discussions we should take now, because the alternative to this discussion is the 19th century nation state model, which I don't think would be very helpful to Europe. It would be neither helpful economically nor politically, nor for the social life of people around here. And this is already my answer to the economic question. Also, I'm convinced that just look at the economists from Central Europe, which are actually nowadays they're called Austrian economists, but some of them are not Austrian, as you know. They are being rediscovered for very obvious reasons, because even capitalism is now looking back to Schumpeter, for instance. So it makes obviously reason to return to this idea how to build economic policy in such a region, and being innovative at the same time and not following the ideas that you had. And the last question was about culture, yes, culture, if I may also say something. There is no alternative to the integration through culture and education. In the book, we are both strongly asking for an introduction of a competence of the European Union also for culture and education. It is not there. And since the beginning of the European integration project, it was willingly not part of the project. And we think this was a mistake and is a mistake. Why is this so? Because the prime ministers and ministers of culture and education in the member countries do not want to get culture lost, because they feel they want to write their history books for the school children. They want to show that the Viennese people have defended Christianity twice against the Turkish invaders and so on. They don't want to share this memory. That's one of the things we have to. We have to try to share this memory. I think there's no alternative to giving more rights on a European scale to culture. And because it plays a role, one has to mention in this context the name of the Jewish culture. Because it was said, where is Central Europe? I think one of the definitions is where Jewish culture played an important role in making a lot of these innovations possible. And when the border is somewhere where the Jewish migration came from the Mediterranean side, or whether it came from the Russian and Polish side. This might be a quite good definition where Central Europe stops in the south. But I know this is a contentious issue to talk about the influence of Jewish culture in Hungary. That's why I stop here. But even contentious issues the Central Europeans should talk about.
And I will continue on this subject concerning culture. I fully share the opinion of Emil I think that we need more common responsibility on this. But I think it would be too short to look only to the responsibility of a commissioner or what is the case of the European Union to do and so on and so on. Because in reality, if you are looking to culture, it is already in common. I think we have, sometimes it's tried, I don't know what it means nowadays here in Hungary in this direction, but you have to say, I think the agenda on culture is a very common, even European, and I might say in a certain direction, even partly a global situation. I think which has to be seen. The cultural life is working here in this direction. I think the chance of Central Europe is, I think, to name it, because in Central Europe on culture, everything is mixed, and out of this mixed situation, the richdom is coming, because it was a kind of competition and addition. I think competition because the one wanted to be as good as the other or even better, but it is also a composition in the sense that they are really working together. I'm always saying some examples. I'm chair of the Gustav Mahler Youth Orchestra. Gustav Mahler is born close to Jihlava, Iglau in German, in Czech Republic. And in his life, he went through whole Europe, conducting and so on and so on. And even ending in the United States, which was depending on the issues of the time here being in charge. This Gustav Mahler Youth Orchestra was founded by Claudio Abbado, and so on and so on. And I can continue on this. And I'm always telling my beloved Austrian citizens, I'm inviting you to all the famous poets, composers, and. On which we are proud, the Austria cultural nation. If you look where they are born, from where they are coming and where they have been, I think it was nearly everywhere, sometimes also in Austria. And I think this we have to confess. Please don't feel offended, but I'm trying this sometimes also concerning Hungary, because if I move to Hungary, I'm always meeting Liszt fans, for sure, from the airport starting wherever I go, and so on and so on. But Liszt Ferenc was born what is now Austria. It was a part of the Hungarian kingdom. It has to be said quite clear. But I think he tried four times a life to learn Hungarian language, and he failed. He was not the only one failing, because it is extremely complicated. He was so Hungarian that he is buried beside Richard Wagner, who is, I think, a very famous Hungarian, by the way. Here you can see, that's normal. That's not an exception. And I think we can be happy about this. And so far, I think we have to fight more for this common responsibility on culture here in this context. I may continue also telling quite shortly family story. My whole family, on father and mother's side, are in the construction business. I think no famous architect, but they were working nearly on every field downstairs. The most impressive case was for me my grandfather, because he was responsible for building up on a low level. He was Bauleiter, I think, looking to the daily business, what is going on in construction in Odessa. In Odessa, where one of the 42 music halls, opera houses, and so on, by the architect's office of Fellner and Helmer was built. You have one also in Budapest, and so on and so on. I think this was in a certain way Europe, without any discussion. I think they had the interest to take the best that it is really done. I think I had the problems as a child to find where is Odessa situated. But later on, I was able to visit this building, and I was deeply impressed. So far, I think it is in a certain way European, or may I say even international, and I think that's extremely difficult. Allow me to make one remark. I think we are both twins on the subject of Central Europe. So far, we have sometimes to show distinctions. His criticism concerning my criticism on mentioning subsidiarity is not only subsidiarity. Subsidiarity is only functioning if there is solidarity. I think these are twins, it is by Christian Catholic Social Lehre, by social ethics teaching on the Christian side, I think quite clear. And we have to say, we are doing this kind of nationalism not as a nationalism, it is a kind of egoism. Because we have the feeling time is becoming dangerous by globalization, by a lot of things, the production of weapons is as high as it's never been now, and. And we want to protect ourselves. And so far we are trying to withdraw from a greater responsibility to be protected locally, regionally, that there's not too much interference. I think there's a beautiful saying in German, jeder denkt an sich, nur ich denke an mich. Everybody is considering him or herself, only me, I'm thinking of myself. That's a tendency which we have in politics, and that is extremely dangerous. And in this way we have to overcome it, because we need subsidiarity, you are totally right, and we need solidarity, because otherwise it's not working.
Iván, elnézést. Szeretném a barátainkat bátorítani, hogy magyarul is lehet kérdezni, nyugodtan, egy kétnyelvű találkozó.
És van tolmácsolás nyugodtan.
I'm Isabella Algardi, and I'm from here. And I read your book with great interest, and I found many of the points that you raised highly relevant, and I would encourage everybody to read the book. What I was thinking with regard to the question of nation state and belonging, having grown up amongst and having done research amongst very ordinary women in Transylvania and Vojvodina and in Southeast Hungary, when they told me around 2010 that, well, you know, communism failed, the socialist bloc dissolved, but now maybe in the EU. So there was this sense of hope for the EU, for some kind of larger entity, the ability to belong to some larger entity that would give hope, that would give some kind of utopistic vision, or just maybe not utopistic, but a certain type of vision for a more positive outcome or life chances. Then I read Paul Gillespie, who was saying that how ironic is that people like to form belonging through shared past rather than through shared futures. And I was wondering how you would reflect on this.
Excellent.
Bokányi Péter vagyok, és irodalommal szoktam foglalkozni, és ezen belül a közép-európai groteszk jelenségével többek között. Ennek kapcsán nem is annyira kérdés, mint inkább egy töprengés. Közelmúltban találkoztam egy rendezvényen a Prágai Tükör című folyóirat főszerkesztőjével, akiről azt mondták, hogy ő a csehországi magyarok társaságának a képviselője. És egy 60 év fölötti emberről volt szó. És kérdeztem tőle, hogy akkor meséljen a társaságról, és mondta, hogy igazán nincs ilyen társaság, ő Kassamellét született Csehszlovákiában. Aztán elment az ország fővárosába tovább tanulni, Prágába, aztán ott letelepedett, mert újságíróként ott volt munkalehetőség, egyszer csak jött egy politikai döntés, és ő hirtelen csehországi magyar lett. Mert hogy a közép-európai létezésnek az egyik fundamentum, azt gondolom, az, hogy gyalogol fölöttünk a történelem. És engedjenek meg, ez inkább csak kísérlet, hogy felidézzek, illetve elmondjak egy viccet, amiről meggyőződésem, hogy ez csak Közép-Európában értik. Egy interjú egy idős emberrel, aki elmeséli azt, hogy 18-ban született a monarchiában, ifjúkorát Csehszlovákiában és Magyarországon töltötte, Aztán Oroszország, Szovjetunióban teljesedett ki az élete, és most Ukrajnában fog meghalni, és hát a poént ismerik, akik ismerik, hogy akkora bácsi biztos sokat utazott, és azt mondja, hogy nem kérem, én a lábamat nem tettem ki munkácsról. Tehát, és akkor itt szeretnék visszakapcsolni Bába Iván bevezetőjére két szempontból. Az egyik, hogy nagyon köszönöm, hogy elolvashattam ezt a könyvet, mert hogy ön értékein túl, valóban az egyik legnagyobb erénye az, hogy nagyon sok mindent enged tovább gondolni. Például a közép-európai identitás kérdését, és azt gondolnám, illetve és ezt kérdezem is egyben, hogy lehet, hogy ebben áll az identitásunknak a lényege, attól, abban a félelemben, abban a pszichózisban, amit Bába Iván említett.
Thanks very much for your somewhat inspiring analysis, and you've made me think. A couple of people here know, I've been doing research on civil religion, and it seems to me that the European Union really needs something akin to a civil religion, as Rousseau first articulated it. It would provide the kind of solidarity that would transcend some of the more, shall we say, fundamentalist identities. It worked in the United States for a long time, but it has had its problems with the, sort of, shall we say, imperial urges of the United States. The other thing I'd like to suggest is that if we were to continue this conversation, it would be very, very interesting to look much more fully at the economic issues and the economic structures that may mitigate against the kind of solidarity that you really feel is needed, and I feel is needed as well. Because I'm afraid I don't think it's going to be Joseph Schumpeter who provides the vision. And what I fear is that it's going to be that wonderful person who some thought was a philosopher who originally came from Russia, but affected a great many people, including in the high-tech industries, Ayn Rand, who epitomizes the importance, in her words, of selfishness. And that is in fundamentally driving American capitalism.
Thank you. Any answers?
Yes.
If I may, the... why the question why two people create loyalty because of shared past, not because of shared futures? I believe that we have in Europe so much experience of failed shared futures that we're told people that they are. So there is no, at the moment, there is no desire for utopias. There is rather a desire for understanding the past. Because especially in Central Europe, we have so many layers of past. And that's the thing that can be helpful. Because most of these layers, if you look into Central European cities, comprise various ethnic groups, various religious groups, various social developments. I've lived in the city of Krakow, and there you have a German layer, an Austrian layer, even a Czech layer, a Polish layer, certainly a Polish layer, Jewish layer, and so on and so on. And that's very typical. So looking into the these sort of layers of history is our form of dystopia, or utopia maybe. And that's why a lot of research is being done on politics of memory. And I think this is very important that we are doing this. But we have to be careful because sometimes politics of memory is being used like in the 19th century, creating again national narratives. I was in Warsaw 2 weeks ago, and they asked me to talk about the culture of politics of memory. And I said in one sentence only, at the moment, politics of memory, Memory battles are helping the nationalists. Memory battles are helping the nationalists. And it is true, unfortunately. But still, I would insist that historians, not only historians, but academics, have to do this work and to communicate with the politics on these layers of memory. So this is the only form of utopia I think I would accept at the moment, and the majority of people accepts, is
looking in the, into these forms of memory and creating loyalty out of this. And it's not bad if we Central Europeans talk about our past, the memory we have. If we need a shared civic religion, like the US still has, one can say, to a certain extent, I agree. I wouldn't call it civic religion, because religion in the European context really means religion and church. But I would say that we need a shared understanding of the failures and successes of our development, historic development in Europe, which makes it so fascinating, because there it's the only part where I believe in progress. I believe that one can really learn from history. It may be naive, but I believe when there is a continent anywhere, it's Europe which can learn from history. You can name all the historic experience that our countries had to live through. So we have the best chances to do something with the past, to try to come to grips or to understand the past. Maybe this is too idealistic, but that's the only idealism that I would accept at the moment, because otherwise I fully agree that liberalism did not bring the best form of economic development to the Western world. We know about the advantages, but we also know by now about the disadvantages, the income differences, and so on. And this is one of the reasons why the criticism of liberalism is hard to contain, because it is true that the differences of incomes has been and is increasing in liberal democracies. But there, I'm not an expert. I'm just saying what I understand is happening at the moment.
And my friends, I'm continuing with history. We have a certain tendency in the time of difficulties where we have not the right way to perceive how the current actual situation is and what might be the perspective, we have a tendency to look backwards. I think we have to look how it was. And maybe we can have it again. And there were some good things and so on and so on. It's interesting for me that we have a certain tendency in some countries with difficulties to look back to the former empires. We have it by Vladimir Ilyich Putin. He is looking back to the Stalinist empire mixed up with the Tsarist time. Here we have been great. You have the same with Erdogan. He is offering even his Arab neighbors that the Ottoman Empire should be back. The interesting answer of the Arabs is, I think we know how it was, thank you very much. But the tendency is for sure here. You have it concerning our beloved British friends, looking back to the Commonwealth of Nations, even not learning out of the current situation. Theresa May was going to India and saying, dear Prime Minister Modi, let's make Commonwealth of Nations free trade association area commands common and so. And clever enough, he was asking, how is it with the free mobility of labor force? That was the reason why the Brexit was appearing. Finished. And even, I think it's always a little bit different with America, but I think it is back to the Monroe Doctrine, America for the Americans, is also a certain way backwards existing. I think fair enough, I have to say, Trump is also moving out of the former role of the United States, because it is partly also over-intentioning the United States in the responsibility. And I think that is one of the crucial difficulties which are existing and on which we Europeans have to face. I think we are still living partly in the time, not the Hungarians, not the Austrians, where we have been big, and where Europe was extremely important. I think we have to learn the lessons. We Europeans are 7% of the global population. We are still, and that is peak, 20 to 22% of the economic power. And then we have a big figure which is horrible. We are consuming 50% of the real positive outcomes of the world. This is creating the ecological problems. This is creating migration and so on and so on. And I think what we have to do, and it is extremely important to consider what means Europe. For what is Europe good? What can we contribute in cooperation with others? I think, may I say, Central Europe, and asking about the importance of Central Europe for the future of Europe is also a question, what is a contribution by the connections which we have, we can have out of Central Europe to other parts of the world? That's of extreme importance, which we are not doing enough, I think, because we are challenged on this subject. So far, I think, let me say, it's the first book. Second book we were writing on Central Europe, and the first book looking to the futures of these areas. I think we need a lot of further books, not written by us, but by others, how we can manage here this challenge. It is a real challenge. And I think here we have to listen to this famous Chinese saying, may you live in interesting times. My friends, we are living in interesting times. Let's do it at the best.
I know it's late, but I can't manage not to ask this question, or maybe we can discuss it in details during the reception. But you mentioned in your book, and this is very much in our common debate today, that there is a shift of power from the West, and it became more obvious and famously understood by Brexit. Even if Brexit would never happen, it would Brexiternity. Brexiternity is a new expression, an exit which never happens. That's the absurdity of our time. Even in that case, the shift, the political power shift, is obvious. But it's what is not obvious, where the center is going to be. And you suggest in your book that the center is going to move towards the east, that in other words, it will be in Central Europe. And this is echoed very much by politicians like Viktor Orban, and that's kind of a new discourse. Now, my question is it really true, and do you see an agreement around this, a kind of consent among European politicians or political parties, or it is just a dream, a product of our fantasy? Mitteleuropa Ostwärts, that was the title of Karl Schlögel's book. I recommend it to you to read it. A German essay writer, historian, and writes wonderfully about cities and Central European spirits many years ago. And again, he's writing about it today. But how realistic it is in real political power terms.
Yes. Perhaps it was missed in the discussion that Professor Brix referred to the need of a revolution several times. Now, in this part of the world, revolution can have positive connotations and negative connotations as well. So, and we also added adjectives to the revolutions like negotiated revolution or lawful revolution, etc. So what do you mean by this revolutionary need? What type of revolution?
First, to answer the question of Ferenc, may I say, I think these changes and moving eastwards and so on is first of all a consequence of the end of the division of Europe. Because I think I grew up in the time where being a Viennese, you have been a European in the common understanding of this time at the rim. I think you have been situated very much eastwards. I think 60 kilometers from Vienna eastwards, that was the end of the world in reality, no? Not geographically, but by the understanding. And it was another part and so on, that was a common understanding. I think that fell down. The advantage is, for example, in my country, it's not anymore the feeling that the East is on the rim. I think in a certain way, Vienna was able to return a little bit to the center, or not being so outside. I think that was the other move which was really happening. And now we are learning that the world is a little bit bigger than Europe. And there are a lot of parts here, and we have to look in this and to gain here more connections and so on and so on. And to change, and this is mentioned, and Emil is very much fighting for this, and I share his opinion, that also Europe in its configuration have to follow this. There's a proposal, I think we don't need only Brussels, we need Krakow, for example, just to make a proposal in this direction. And for sure it's quite necessary. I think we have to teach our friends in the West that they are in the danger to be a little bit more at the rim. They are very much convinced that they are in the center. I think not at all. I would say parts of France are not anymore totally in the center. It's going more here to the rim, and so on and so on. And also other parts of Europe have to learn that they are very decisive in this direction, but it is only one point in the development, because further on I think it will even move more forward in other direction. It's depending on the competition between states, nations, economies, and so on and so on, in which directions here it's going. But it is an extremely important question. And we mentioned it, Ferenc, because we have the impression it is not really understood. It's not really understood. I think we are not really focusing on this, even by primitive things. I'm always mentioning the composition of the European Commission. If you look, who is getting responsibility and having an important job, and who is not getting an important job? I think if you follow the last commissions through the responsibilities, some countries being aside got less importance. Lost less responsibility and so on, which for sure is not right, because by principle, European Union is based that all are equal and have the same chances. They don't have the same chances. And I think here we need a discussion in this direction, I think, to change this attitude. The rest is yours.
The rest is silence now. Revolution, yes, willingly used on various occasions. What do I mean by that? I'm convinced that to change the system into a system which is more accepted by people, we need to talk about the basic idea: what is the social contract? What is the social contract between the people? Why they give power to various institutions? Do we have the same social contract that we in Europe in the 18th century developed? And my answer is no. It's very obvious that we need many more occasions that the civil society has possibilities to interfere in the power process, in the decision-making process. That's so obvious. That's different from the 18th century. That's the first part of the revolution. The second part of revolution is that's not an intellectual revolution, but that's a political revolution. I mean, that's the idea that the Pax Americana, that the Americans are safeguarding and securing Europe and the Western European security, is not sustainable. We need to do something about it. So we need some sort of, that's why I said power, and I liked Mr. Borrell talking about European power. We need a European sovereignty in security issues, in defense issues, and that is a real revolution, because nobody among us remembers a time when it was different. So there is an intellectual revolution, talking about the social contract again, and there is this political revolution talking about European sovereignty without the Americans making the decisions of even the head of NATO on the European theater always must be an American general. There is something wrong. This doesn't fit into our times. So that's why I believe in revolution.
Just one remark to it, what you mentioned, that if the organic structure of the European Union was completed after the past elections, if we look at the political map of the leading positions and the leaders of the European Union, none of the leading positions was offered to any politician from our region, from the Central Europe. The President of the European Parliament, the Commission, the European Bank, the European External Action Service, none of them is coming from this region. There is represented Spain, France, Belgium, Germany, and Italy. They are the leaders of these five organs of the European Union. This is more than symbolic.
In history, we had only two. My main colleague,
Jerzy Busek and Donald Tusk. And Donald Tusk, yes, yes. Yes, Polish, yes, and now nobody. So that it is more than symbolic, I guess. Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, I think that we have to finish this extremely interesting discussion. We are very thankful and grateful for your presence here, especially for the book. How I mentioned, it is a very inspiring, especially for us here. And thank you very much for your activity here that you are, and thank you for your friendship, especially that you are, if I may dare say so. Let's continue. Thank you for your attention, and we are going to continue it. And thank you for you as well. We wish you all the best. We are going to continue. We can promise it. And if we don't meet, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to all.